Now, whenever you're building out a GraphQL API on AWS, you're probably going to be using Appsync. And if you would like real-time subscriptions and notifications, then you're probably going to be using Appsync. But as with most things on AWS, there are different ways that you can approach building out these APIs. And that's why in this video, I'm going to be showing you my top three ways that I build and scale out my Appsync APIs, so that way you can take advantage of these methods in your next. Now, we're going to approach this from a beginner to advanced scenario. But definitely stick around to the end, even if there is a section that doesn't quite pertain to you, because I am going to be offering up projects for each step along the way. But with that all out of the way, let's go ahead and check out option number one. Now, the first method here is going to be the Appsync console. This should hopefully make sense. If you want to build out an Appsync API, the easiest way is going to be through the console here. Now, I'll admit this isn't how I actually build from scratch my Appsync APIs, mainly because you want to be using this as an iterative approach. I actually use this primarily to test out my existing APIs. What you'll find is that creating them, you have two options. You can do it from scratch, or you can do it from an existing DynamoDB table. I'm going to say from scratch here, but you can give it a name and then you can provide it additional details. You have to remember that this initial schema knows nothing about the type of application you're trying to build. You have to come in here and create all of your queries, mutations, and subscriptions yourself. Now, where this shines is where you already have an existing API set up. In this case, this is for Halloween. I created a candy corn application and I wanted to test out that this was in fact working. So I can go ahead and check out my settings. I can view any API keys that need to be iterated upon. I can see I actually have one expired right here. So I can create one more. And now in my query section, I can say, yeah, let's go ahead and create a guess on how many pieces of candy corn were inside of my jar here. So the guess is going to be 10. And then I can set the name to be Michael. And sure enough, when I go ahead and run this, I get an ID back showing that I did persist this inside of DynamoDB. And just in case you're curious, I can actually come in here and see all of the existing guesses as well by listing them all out inside of my database. Selecting on items, and then I can have all the names, IDs, and guesses select right here. And now you have all the guesses. Stick around if you want to see just how many were actually in that jar. So again, as mentioned, I use this to primarily iterate on my API. I can always come up and change my schema if I like, add in additional fields, or come over to the settings and say, you know what, I actually do want to enable logging. So that way I can view these logs in CloudWatch, and you can specify the logging level if you'd like as well. One downside is that this isn't infrastructure as code. So any changes that I make to this API, I can't use in my next project. I have to start from scratch. Now, in my opinion, a much better way of building out full stack applications is actually going to be with Amplify Studio. This is going to be a graphical user interface that you can use to build out your next application. You can see that I can come up here, give it a name. We'll just say the Halloween sample based off of the time of this recording. Halloween is coming up, and this will create an Appsync API as well as a couple other services that most applications will need based off of common settings. Now, what I really like about this is that you have this studio environment. So it's really easy to come in here and not just create an Appsync API, but now we can add things like authentication, wire up different data models, and do a bunch more. I definitely encourage you to export out. But when I come over here to data, I can add my model. And this is doing a lot of the same functionality as we saw in the previous video. But now that I can say these are going to be my candy corn guesses, and then I can set up my additional fields right here, as well as authentication rules to the side. And then once I'm ready to deploy, it'll put this over in my AWS account. So I can run this locally and deploy it to AWS Amplify. Now, in case you're wondering what this architecture ends up looking like, is that you have a user going to some kind of front end like Next.js or whatever, and then you have your Appsync API talking directly to DynamoDB. Now, there's something to be said about this approach. It is super, super powerful, not only because you can have this graphical user interface, but this Amplify pull command right here means that you can take all of this code and bring it locally into your application and start iterating on it through the use of the Amplify CLI. And in doing so, it's going to give you all of those operations that were generated for you over in the Amplify Studio console. But now you get the flexibility of also having the option to look at your schema that you created as well. You can iterate on it as well. And maybe I want to add on something different than a name and a guess. Maybe I also want to have the number of attempts that they had as well. And I can say, you know what, you can do that. And that's going to be an integer. And by running Amplify pull, this will push it up and be in sync with Studio. And again, this is catered towards a full stack experience. So that way it's not just an Appsync API, it's something more real world where here's the application. I can say, you know what, this is going to be focus on our guessing right here. And then the amount of guesses that I'm going to say is 850. I can submit that. And then over down at the bottom, I believe we have focus order. And in case you're wondering, the total amount inside of this jar is going to be 859. It was actually my cousin Marcos who won that night. So he was able to take over this complete jar of candy corn. Now, with that said, I did want to flip back over here and talk about some of the considerations that you have to take into mind when you're building with Amplify. You are in their ecosystem. You have to do things their way. So let's say we're building an application where we want to have AppSync talk to an AI service, right? Typically, what this would look like is that you have Next.js on our front end, some kind of sign-in mechanism. We're going to be using Cognito here. And in this application, we want our users to upload a receipt that's going to be stored in this S3 bucket right here. Now, the ID, the S3 key for this receipt is what we're going to be using in AppSync. And AppSync is going to be talking to something like Textract. We're going to look at that receipt, extract all the information, and show that as an expense item inside of our app. Now, AppSync can talk directly to these data sources. However, you don't have the ability to do that easily if you're using Amplify. What I'm going to show you is what I want to do versus how I would want to do things the Amplify way. AppSync is using a pipeline resolver to talk directly to Amazon Textract, which is then going to persist this inside of DynamoDB. And again, my front end is going to be notified of this expense report item. Using Amplify, I have to use a Lambda function to do this because, again, I don't have an easy way to hook up and control these pipeline resolvers. Now, the thing to note about Amplify is that you are within their ecosystem. You don't have the full breadth of AWS at your disposal. You do have to do things their way. And sometimes that means using a Lambda function or using a different architecture than what you might want to use yourself. To really drive that home, let's say that we have this expense application here. This expense application is going to take in a receipt that'll be stored in an S3 bucket. And presumably when it gets done, I'm going to use the ID of that receipt to perform some machine learning. So that way all the data that I care about is going to be extracted from that receipt. To really drive that home, let's say that we have this Starbucks receipt right here. I'm going to create an expense report. And it has a bunch of things that I care about, like the total, the subtotal, the merchant. You can see a Starbucks right up top, as well as the date. Now, over in my application, I can say I'm going to upload this receipt here simply by dragging it over. And this is a cool feature of the UI components within Amplify. But all I did was upload it. You can see that information was automatically extracted from that image. Pretty cool stuff. However, it's a story of two architectures here. AppSync is able to talk to this service, Amazon Textract, directly. But if I'm using Amplify CLI, I don't have an easy way of doing that. Best option would be to use a Lambda function. Now, this is another service that comes with its own set of ideas and architecture. What I want to do is have AppSync talk to this directly, so that way it can use a pipeline resolver to go straight to Amazon Textract and through the use of DynamoDB to persist this. So that is a consideration that you want to make. If you're looking for sort of my go-to thoughts on it, if I'm creating something where I know most of the requirements and the application isn't going to change a lot over time, then I'm going to be using Amplify Studio to help scaffold my application and maybe using the CLI to iterate on it just a little bit. However, this takes us to our third and final option here, which is using the CDK to construct our AppSync API. And this is going to be a great option if you're shipping something to production and you don't know all of your requirements up front, but you have a good sense of how you want to get started. This is going to give you the full breadth of AWS to work with and be a fantastic choice if you're trying to push something out into the real world. Not saying that you can't with Amplify, but again, we're going for maximum flexibility here. So over in the code, we can check out what it looks like in that expense tracker here. I have my schema pulled up and you can see that this is actually using the same type of at model and at auth directives from Amplify. And the cool thing is that the Amplify team and the AppSync team joined forces and we have a L3 construct. This is going to be a higher level construct, which is going to give us a lot of the benefits of using something like Amplify with the ability to fall back into the CDK. Now, to put that into practice, you can see that I have this API directory here. And when I jump into it, I'm constructing my AppSync API as infrastructure from code. So I have an easy way to redeploy this and reuse this across projects. I give it the schema definition here over in my schema.graphql file. I tell it that I'm setting up Cognito, but note what I have to do. I don't have the ability, like in the Amplify CLI, to say something easy, Amplify add auth. I have to construct my Cognito user pools on my own. But with great power comes great product. So I can come down here and I can have the additional functionality of connecting straight to Textract. Now this does mean that I have to wire this up myself. In fact, if I come over to this textract.ts file, you can see that I get to write these Lambda-like functions, which are actually just going to be AppSync talking directly to AWS services. But it is a cool way to have a very fast, very reliable application without having to manage an additional service like an AWS Lambda function. Now, I didn't want to skip over this because it is an interesting part. If we look at my schema here, this is still going to create my database for me. And in fact, it's going to give me all those CRUD operations out of the box. But as mentioned, I can fall back and say I have an additional mutation, which is going to be using Textract in between. And I can also subscribe to this as well. So I have full control over how this subscription is going to take place, in addition to having full control over how items are going to be put into DynamoDB. Now, because this is a CDK application and not actually anything to do with Amplify outside of this additional construct, I do have to do the wiring of the front end and the back end myself. Again, the idea here is that we're in a more manual way of writing our code, but we do have it reproducible across projects. Essentially, once you do it one time, you have this set up in your GitHub repo or whatever version control you're using, while having the ability to use any AWS service in any configuration that you like. In fact, I can even use the Amplify CLI to generate the types for my AppSync API and use them across my front end and my back end. You can see I get all of this and I didn't have to write a single thing. Now, on one last note, we do have the ability to drop back to the L2 construct. This is going to be a lower level construct, which still gives you some really nice benefits. The reason why I don't use that as much these days is because the L3 construct gives me so much flexibility while still allowing me the option to fall back. So it's not an either or. I get to use both the L3 in addition to whatever properties I want from the L2 construct in tandem. And just like the Amplify Studio version, I can still come over to my Pages application, check out my index file, and have access to all those queries and operations that were generated on my behalf, and use them within my application in conjunction with whatever settings I want to be having, such as storage, auth, my API, of course, etc. So again, I would use this for most practical applications where I'm going to be mixing in Amplify and the CDK to build out my apps. If I'm building out something small, something like a Halloween project, maybe like my crossword project, then I would be using Amplify CLI all day, every day, because it is a fantastic way to get started very quickly. And there you have it. Those are my options and recommendations for how you should be building out your AppSync APIs. If you found this helpful or have any questions, feel free to go ahead and shoot me a comment. Like the video if you enjoyed the repos that I showed off, but all of those will be available in GitHub in the description down below. Thank you all so much. And until next time, happy coding. Peace.